Welcome, everybody. I think we'll just get started because we have three speakers today, and we want to make sure there's plenty of time to get through everything that they have to share with us from across the world, which is just fantastic. Please continue to include your name, your location, your institution. Already, it looks like we have three continents, which is just fantastic. So I'm going to dive right in without further ado, but just a reminder that we love for the chat box to be a way for people to find each other, to collaborate along with learn from our speakers. So for those of you who were not able to join us last month, we had a wonderful webinar on a focus on endometriosis with speakers similarly from different sides of the world. If you missed it, the recording, as always with our webinars, is now posted on our website. The link is at the bottom, but you can also find it in the chat box, thanks to Jalen, the MPH student who helps us to support running these webinars each month. So please go find it, share it with your networks if this is an issue that's of particular interest to you. Again, just a reminder, we are at the third webinar of this winter into spring season. So very excited to have such fantastic speakers with us today. We will have one more on May 11th. At the bottom of this and also in the chat box, you can see the sign up mailing to join our mailing list if you're not already on it. And that way you'll just always get the reminders of the webinars. But we also post them on Twitter and share them in other ways in case you miss it. So hope you can join us for what will be our final webinar for this season, and then we'll take a break over the summer months here on the East Coast of the US, and we will pick up again in the fall. So I just wanted to put this up here. This is a piece that a number of us wrote, including a former student of mine back in 2016, which just tried to highlight, at that time, there was very little funding to tackle this issue of addressing menstruation in the workplace or exploring this issue. And so a number of us wrote a paper just so that we could, you know, try to raise awareness of the issue, see if people would start to think about it and maybe do some work on it. And there already were people doing work on it, but we didn't feel that there was sufficient. There was a lot left to be done, as I think you'll feel there still is after today. But excitingly, just a few years later, we have three fantastic speakers who will share with us what we have started to learn, both in terms of research and in terms of intervention. So when we say menstruation in the workplace, what do we mean? Well, when we think about it, it could refer to all manner of places. You're going to hear probably about specific places today in the presentations, but we do want you to sort of be thinking large, be thinking wide, be thinking about all the places where there are people working in your communities, in your cities, in your towns, who may have to manage their menstruation while they are working. This is not meant to exclude those who work from home, who may also struggle with managing their period. So there's growing attention globally, which has been really wonderful, primarily in the media. You can see continents all over the world talking about menstrual leave, talking about the workplace and menstruation, talking about the needs that people have and the ways in which employers have typically addressed women's periods, which has not been particularly period friendly, one could say. And so what's really exciting about having three speakers talking about what they're doing here today is that we will hear how maybe we're going to start finally tackling this issue and moving beyond this place of very little attention and awareness of it as something. So what types of challenges might arise? Well, you're again going to hear a lot more specifically today what some of the issues are. And so I don't want to spend time talking about them too much, but for those of you who are perhaps new to coming to hear about periods, which I know is not many of you, it may be around the kind of access you have to toilets with water and disposal, supervisors who may not be supportive of the needs that workers have, insufficient supplies or materials on site, or an inability to bring them, ongoing menstrual stigma, which we know is an issue everywhere, how far you have to travel and the implications for that, particularly if you're bleeding heavily or it's the early days of your period in the month, if you have heavy bleeding or pain, and potentially the inability to miss even an hour if you need to rest take breaks because you're uncomfortable or need to clean clothing. So just to say, this is just maybe the tip of the iceberg, and you're going to hear a lot more today from our speakers. So just sort of my last slide on that is sort of the social and financial costs that we need to think about in terms of what someone may have to address, what it may mean for a company, what it may mean for their workers, and what it may mean for sort of the economy when people are unable to have a safe and dignified way to manage their period while working. And lastly, we always like to have a quote. So gender equality is more than a goal in itself. It's a precondition for meeting the challenge of reducing poverty, promoting sustainable development, and building good governments. And I think we use this quote today because we feel very strongly, as I'm guessing all of you do, that gender equality in the workplace is essential, and assuring that everyone who menstruates has the opportunity to change and manage their period as they need to is part of that equality. So enough from me, moving on today's webinar. Hopefully I can see you have the chat box open, which is fantastic, and it's great to see where people are. Please keep sharing where you are and what organizations and so on, and share those links so that people can learn from you. And we hope the chat box becomes sort of a network unto itself. Please open up your Q&A box as well, so that you can include questions for our speakers and they can answer after they've talked, but I will also address them at the end. So hopefully we'll have a little time for that. If you are tweeting, we love when you tweet. You can see the hashtags to use down at the bottom so that we raise awareness of this issue and have more people aware of this topic. Our speakers today, you probably know who they are, but just listing them out there. And we have, we're gonna hear from Sweden, we're gonna hear about a project in Nepal, and we're gonna hear from Uganda, which is really exciting. So I am going to turn it over to Rebecka, dialing in from Sweden. If you'll just unmute yourself. So please.
Hi,
go for it.
All right. Hi, everyone. My name is Rebecca, and I'm here from the Swedish organization MENSEN, which is an NGO that was founded in 2014. Could you change the slide, please, Marnie?
Yes.
And our goal as an organization is to strive for menstrual equity in society as a whole and raise awareness on all kinds of menstrual issues. And a major part of our work is different kinds of educational efforts. And today I'll talk about one of those concepts that we call period works, which targets menstruators' needs and rights in work life and at the workplace. Next slide, please. And this project was launched in 2019, and it was financed by a project grant from the Swedish Agency for Gender Equality. And if you don't know where Sweden is located, I've done a little map. So it's in Northern Europe. And in the beginning, or the first year, we did a lot of research plus a pilot study to gather data at an app company called Forza Football, which is located in Gothenburg. And we also held a training for them. And after that, we saw a need and also wanted to continue the project and develop educational material for a broader public and make it as accessible as possible. So our next step was to target trade unions, since they have the possibility to reach hundreds of thousands of workers. And I'm aware that the situation might be different from country to country, but in Sweden, the trade union movement is quite strong, and the majority of all employees and workers are unionized. So it's a very good way to reach this group. Next slide, please. And the material at the moment that we have produced is all free of charge, at least the material for trade unions and safety representatives. And some of it is in English, if you want to take a look later. And just last week, we also launched educational packages for workplaces. But as you know, working with menstrual equity can be a bit controversial. So I'll also show some of the initial reactions we got at the next slide, please. And these are literal reactions that we saw in social media, but also from editorials in major Swedish newspapers. And as you can see, people were pretty upset in the beginning, but we kind of powered through and the critique cooled off now that we can show more results and positive effects. Next slide, please. So in at least the Swedish context, there isn't much research done on the subject, which is one of the reasons that we wanted to look into this issue in the beginning and then see if we could find potential areas for improvements. So early 2019, we conducted a survey in social media, and for full disclosure, it wasn't like a real scientific study. We did it mainly to collect personal experiences. But recently, the trade union IF Metall did a collaboration with us and campaigned for more period-friendly workplaces. And IF Metall is a union for industrial workers, and that's a very male-dominated field. So we're very happy that they wanted to work with us and raise awareness on menstrual equity. And a part of their campaign was to do a member survey, and they came to quite similar conclusions as our own survey did, which I'll mention soon. But first, a couple of slides on the Swedish work environment law. Next slide, please. And this is an actual quote from the law, that working conditions must be adapted to people's different physical and mental capabilities. And the law covers a bunch of things, but never specifically mentions menstrual health. But we still think it's valid to use the law in argumentation for menstrual rights. Next slide, please. And legislation regarding work environment is obviously different from country to country, but the Swedish law is pretty much divided into three parts that regulate social, organizational, and physical work environment. And the purpose is to make sure that your job doesn't get you injured or sick in any way, but it also provides guidelines for preventive measures so that employees can thrive at the workplace. And comparing the rights that one is entitled to with obstacles that menstruating employees experience, it's obvious that there is a gap that we found. And also that you can use this law in these three areas to support the cause for period-friendly workplaces. And I'll bring up some quotes from our survey and problematic areas that we identified and that IF Metall's survey also pretty much confirmed. Next slide. And the first area is poor toilets, and a quote that said, sometimes we don't even have access to toilet. All the guys pee behind a nearby bush, but us girls hold it in all day. Next slide. Too high workload, could barely get a break, often bled through my pants. Eventually I had to call in sick during the days I was on my period because it was an unbearable situation and resulted in the loss of income. Next slide. Negative attitudes and low knowledge. If I'm having a bad day, I often get comments like, why so grumpy, are you on your period? And this happens even though I told my boss that I suffer from severe PMDD. Next slide. Taboo. I put a glass jar with tampons in one of the staff toilets and sent an email to my female colleagues and told them about it. My boss, who is a woman, chose to put the jar away because she didn't think it was appropriate. And next slide. So these factors that I'm going to bring up is they're a combination from lots of different Swedish surveys that list everything that makes people like their job. And it's very obvious that interpersonal aspects are super important, and to have a good atmosphere and, you know, friendly colleagues and a good management, and you, it's important to feel involved and appreciated and having a reasonable workload. And if we look at the quotes that I just mentioned from the survey, it's clear that there are a lot of, you know, areas that can be improved in relation to menstruators' needs. For example, colleagues that show are considerate and understanding if someone tells them that they're suffering from a menstrual related illness, or that the management thinks it's, you know, sure thing to offer period products if the staff wants it, instead of opposing it and putting it away. So next slide, the $1 million question, how we can create a period friendly work life. And first of all, we advocate a broad view and to see a bigger picture and not just look at it as a separate issue that requires a separate policy, because then there's a risk that you look at it once and then it ends up in on the shelf. And instead, menstruators' needs should be acknowledged at every level. And just like gender mainstreaming, it should be menstrual mainstreamed into all kinds of policies that has to do with menstrual rights and well-being, and also being followed up. So key takeaways that we promote for employees, employers, but also employees, of course, and also for just general activism. But this is, of course, if you are in a position as an employee that you feel comfortable and are able to advocate for these questions, which is not always the case. And it's the first step is to look over the toilets and make sure that they're accessible and safe and sanitary to use, and offer period products if the staff needs it. Make sure you the staff can take breaks to change period products, or if they suffer from cramps or need to go to the doctor for an hour or so. And also create supportive environment between co-workers, but also between staff and management. And that way, a person suffering from, for example, endometriosis can share or feel that they can share what they're going through, and which that will make it easier for them at the workplace. And the previous step is also connected to knowledge, and if people have sufficient knowledge about menstruation and the menstrual cycle and how it can affect people, it's more likely that they can be supportive. And lastly, key takeaways for policymakers. Next slide, please. It's to strive for legislation and policies that ensure that employees have the right to sufficient bathrooms at work, and period products if needed, and time to take breaks and having a reasonable workload. And that's all from me. And please visit us at mensen.se if you want to look at the material. Thank you.
Fantastic. That was wonderful. I already have a bunch of questions, but I shall contain myself. I'm starting to wonder how we can do this in every country in the world. So great. And we look forward to asking you questions when we get to the end of all of our speakers. Just a reminder to everybody, and thank you. It's been really fun watching where people are, who they are, where they're working, seeing the links that you're posting. So please do continue to do that in the chat box. And then if you haven't already, I encourage you to open the Q&A box, which should also be at the bottom or top of your screen, so you can begin to post questions for our speakers as they are talking, and they will go in there and respond to them. And then I will check that Q&A box at the end to see what we should discuss all together. So I would, on your screen, keep the chat box and the Q&A box open so you can be sure to ask questions. Okay, so moving along, we are now traveling to Nepal. So Maneshka, if you could unmute yourself, it'd be great to hear from you.
Thank you, Marnie. Namaste and welcome to the section on Nepal. Our work, Warshall's work on menstrual hygiene management in the workplace in Nepal. Next slide, please. Next slide, please. One more, thank you. The objective of the workplace action research that we're doing is to determine if providing adequate MHM. Previous slide, please. Going back to the objective, it's to determine if providing adequate MHM in the workplace contributes to improved business and social outcomes, including women's economic empowerment. We're looking at what are the social and economic costs and benefits of providing adequate MHM, what are internal and external factors that influence implementation of such projects, and what indicators are appropriate for measuring adequate MHM in the workplace. Next slide, please. We're looking at medium and long-term outcomes for impacts on women as well as businesses. For the women, we're looking at improved health, reduced stigma, less psychosocial stress, more comfort, better earnings and advancement opportunities. And for businesses, less turnover and errors, better recruitment practices, and better corporate social responsibility. And for shared impacts, we're looking at less absenteeism and more presenteeism, higher productivity and performance, better job satisfaction and retention and security, as well as better relationships with supervisors. Next slide, please. The project in Nepal is titled Maryadit Karyasthal. This translates to dignified workplace and is being carried out at two factories on the outskirts of Kathmandu. Next slide, please. Many of you probably know Nepal is a landlocked Himalayan state sandwiched between India and China. Next slide, please. Next slide, please.
I think there's a delay, Maneshka.
The project is taking place at two factories on the outskirts of Kathmandu, one at Shangri-La Carpet Factory and the other at Milha Custom Rugs. They're both family-owned hand-woven carpet manufacturers that export to the United States, Europe, and East Asia. The two factories, Shangri-La employs 50 women and 19 men. Milha employs 69 women and 28 men. The factories have a rich history of corporate social responsibility. Next slide, please. We have carried out baseline research at both of the factories, and this is a 35,000 foot snapshot of some of these findings. What we found is that the knowledge base at both the factories is rather low. The education level is also low, and this results in less knowledge about menstrual hygiene management. Also, the health related to menstrual hygiene as well as hygiene practices are not very good. A lot of the women complain about pain, especially those who are unmarried and have not yet had children. There are higher levels of complaints from them. We have found at both the factories that there is incredible owner commitment, and the support systems stemming from this owner commitment is quite amazing, really. It trickles down to the management as well as the supervisors and co-workers. On the looms, we have between 2 and 10 people on a loom. And so if one person is away from the loom because of menstruation, up to 9 other people can be without work that day or for 3 to 5 days, depending on however long they are off work. In Nepal, a country ripe with social norms, especially around menstruation. Of course, even at the workplaces in Nepal, in Kathmandu, social norms do take precedence. Many of the women cannot choose not to participate sometimes in work, also don't participate in religious activities, and also don't cook during these times. The MHM supplies that a lot of the women continue to use are kapura or old cloth. Some of the women do use disposable pads. Next slide, please. We also carried out baseline research among the men. Again, the knowledge base is rather low. Men don't really know a whole lot about the health and hygiene practices. Men claim that women self-impose social norms, and they also are participants in the social norms themselves, the men are. Many of the men talked about how if a woman doesn't have her period, she's considered impure. And then when she's on her period, also she's considered impure. There is a strong culture of silence around menstruation. Many men had never spoken to anyone about menstruation. Some of them even said the first time they found out about menstruation was after marriage. They are very interested in being supportive towards the women in the workplace. And in fact, are proponents of breaking the culture of silence as a result. The men spoke of the need for separate infrastructure for the women, separate toilets for women and MHM-friendly toilets, as well as having products available for the women. Next slide, please. Our intervention is threefold. We have products and infrastructure. Those are disposable pads, reusables, underwear, and carry bags. Female-friendly toilets, MHM sensitization for cleaners, education on the use of products and infrastructure as well. Next slide, please. We are also working on workplace policies and guidance. There is a policy analysis that is taking place, and MHM comments box has been placed so that the women can request things regarding MHM. Discussions with leadership and technical assistance from our team to make amendments on policies. And then policy and awareness for employees, especially on policies that they themselves have been the architects of. Next slide, please. There is also an education and behavior change communication component. We have the Maria Ditkarias, the playing cards, or the dignified workplace playing cards game that is being launched in May. We use a lot of education materials in our light touch engagement each month. There is a snakes and ladders game also being launched in the summer. And we have a three-part dignified menstruation edutainment video that is being launched on International MH Day. Next slide, please. So what are the key takeaways? For researchers, it's that you use a customized approach at each of the workplaces that you work in. We found in the two workplaces in Nepal that we have to have slightly distinct approaches. Also engaging men and understanding their interest in being supportive is very important. Next slide, please. For practitioners, the use of a holistic approach that incorporates products, education, and policy is important. Prioritize light touch engagement. Our engagement is 30 minutes a month, and so we have to be able to compress and condense a lot of information into this 30 minutes in a way that is understandable. And then also cultivating support from the owners, leadership, and management is extremely important, we've found, and it has worked very well to the advantage of the project as well as to the women in the workplaces. Next slide, please. Thank you for being part of this, and I look forward to your questions.
Wonderful. Thank you so much, Maneshka. That was, again, another rich presentation, and I'm scribbling questions to ask, but I will wait till the end. And also, it looks like at least one person has already, oh, two people have put questions in the Q&A box. Please keep up your questions, writing them there, and our speakers can go in and respond to them, or we can take them at the end. Don't be shy. This is a great opportunity to learn from each other, and I'm sure if you have a question, someone else has the same question. Also, please continue to put in the chat box your names, where you are in the world, and links, as Rebecca just did, in case there is reading material, information on your own program or others you've heard about that people might benefit. And also, please try to find each other if you're in the same country. It's a great way to identify who else maybe you can collaborate with on this issue locally. So we are going to move along. So thank you again. Our next speaker is Justine Bukenya, who will be sharing with us the experiences of adult women in Uganda around menstruation and unmet menstrual needs. There were some connection issues, so Justine was kind enough to pre-record. So we're just going to start that off now, I think.
Dr. Justine Bukenya from Makerere University, we conducted this study in 2020 with a group of investigators listed on the slide. We focused our study on unmet menstrual needs among adult women in Uganda. Literature shows that most of the research and practice has focused on young people, specifically younger adolescent girls, and little attention has been given to adult women. This was confirmed from the findings, systematic review findings from a qualitative study, where out of 76 studies, only 12 focused on adult women, and among these, only 3 mentioned workplace experiences. And according to performance monitoring for action study, among women, working women, 17 Nigeria and 19% Burkina Faso reported missing work in a month before the study was conducted due to menstruation challenges. And sadly, 1 in 4 of the women in the lowest wealth group quintile missed work due to menstruation. This pushed us to do this study to investigate how unmet menstrual needs influence women's work, health, and well-being. We set out to do this study in Africa and in Uganda in particular, in Mukono district, which is a central district in Uganda. We recruited women of 3 categories. We concentrated on women in working in markets, and this was our major target. From these women working in markets, we recruited other women working in healthcare facilities nearby, and also teachers in government primary day schools. Due to lack of previous studies, we used an exploratory approach using a mixed method to understand sanitation and menstrual experiences. Qualitatively, we conducted 35 in-depth interviews with women aged 18 to 49 who had menstruation in the past 3 months. These women were recruited in consultation with the local government. Basing on our findings from the qualitative study, a month later, we conducted a survey among 600 women who were aged 18, 45, and had menstruated in the past 6 months. From here, we were able to recruit 435 women who are market tenders. Our results revealed that a quarter of women were using reusable materials. Though a tangible number were using reusable materials, they had a lot of challenges, including lack of ample space to dry the materials, soap for washing. They did not have privacy to wash their materials, had limited access to basins or containers for washing, and did not have enough water. In terms of social support, few women had received social support from anybody at workplace, though about 50 of them mentioned that they had received support from health providers and felt comfortable discussing menstruation issues or challenges with health providers. In particular, we asked women, if your period started unexpectedly in a place, is there someone you could ask to help you? And only 47 answered affirmatively. We compared menstrual health hygiene at home and then workplace. Though many women expressed comfort with the menstrual health hygiene, we see fewer women being comfortable at workplaces. For example, in terms of having a clean place to change the menstrual materials, while 90% mentioned that they were comfortable at work, only 52 were really comfortable at workplace. Discomfort at workplace was really common. However, women persevered to continue working while in menstruation. We asked women, particularly, would you avoid scheduling work if possible during menstruation? And 46 of them, of the market vendors, said they would avoid scheduling work, meaning many women persevered to work during menstruation amid these challenges. So this pushed women to have coping strategies. For example, a 39-year-old had this to say, the way you found me here seated, no, I limit myself. I only sit when I have just padded myself. Then after 30 minutes to 1 hour, I stand up. I do not need stains. I can't stand that embarrassment. About 20% of women missed work during menstruation due to various reasons. The main reason as why they had to be away from places of work was pain. Cramps, abdominal cramps were common and were reported by 75% of women. Other reasons include fatigue, lack of energy, heavy breathing, fevers, and other abdominal symptoms. Others had fears like soiling and bad odor. Also, some were uncomfortable with the materials they were using during menstruation. Some had challenges with sanitary facilities. So absenteeism due to menstruation was perceived in different ways. For a 27-year-old had this to say, no, for me, when I get to know that I'm menstruating because it is much heavy breathing and our toilets are also dirty, I don't come to work till I'm done with menstruating. However, a young lady of 24 years opposed this. They shared this to say, they used to say, a person menstruating does not work, but today, if you sit at home, what will you eat? You also have rent to pay. So menstrual experiences, very few women had sick leave, paid up sick leaves. Actually, these were like 6% of the women. Others had to endure losses, they missed the pay, they missed the profit, and a few had family members to stand in for them, especially those who are in the market. Menstruation comes with a lot of financial costs, and women have to prepare, and many of the women preferred the non-reusable materials. So a 48-year-old had this to say, you have to give it priority and service month. I'll buy this number of packets and keep them there so that when I use one, then I will know I have to replace it. Then a 37-year market vendor had this to say, if I could get another place where I could change that chain that is free, it would be much easier for me. But as you know, ladies, conditions are hard. You have to go pay and change. This study gives us a number of takeaway messages to the practitioners. It's good news. Health providers are really comfortable discussing menstrual challenges with the service providers. So we call upon the practitioners, the service providers, to provide services in a holistic view. For women who are menstruating, kindly attend to their menstrual challenges. Use of reusable materials offers some opportunities, but comes with a lot of challenges. We need to think through how we can address the challenges. Private sanitation facilities are limited, so we need to ensure that all workplaces have adequate private sanitation facilities. Norms that deter women from seeking out support should be addressed. Women need to be counseled to speak out if they experience menstrual challenges and seek support from appropriate people. To the donors, menstruation has significant implications for work, for health, and well-being at work. For women, they miss work, and those who persevere to come and attend their duties do it a lot of stress and discomfort. There is need to incorporate menstrual health in infrastructure to ensure that both the infrastructure and work policies are conducive to women who are menstruating. To the researchers, we thank you that you've reported some findings among young people, but now it's time to look at women who are adults. And while looking at women who work, it's really important to look at women's experience while at workplace. Just concentrating to experience at home is really inadequate. The studies must be comprehensive and sensitive to all ranges, including social cultural considerations of women, access to healthcare, and the availability of resources, how best sanitation infrastructures could be improved, as well as availing products for women to use. People who want to know more about our study, we've already published a paper with BMJ Global Health, and we are thankful to all people who participated and funded this study. Thank you.
Wonderful. So fantastic. Three fantastic presentations today. Again, I have lots of questions, but I see that we already have some in the chat box. And I see that we already have some responses. So that is wonderful. I'm just scrolling through to see if we should, if we can take some of them. Maybe for Maneshka, in terms of the question that Lucy asked about scalability or economic analysis being done to understand the costs and potential for replicating the intervention more widely, do you think you could maybe just speak to that question?
Sure. Thank you for that question, Lucy, and thanks, Marnie. We're actually conducting a full cost-benefit analysis in both at both work sites in both countries that we're working in, both Nepal and Kenya. So yes, we're going to look at scalability as well. We're looking at the financial and economic costs and benefits, as well as the social and social costs and benefits. This will be available in about 6 months.
Great. Thank you, Maneshka, and we look forward to seeing that. And then a question from Bethany Caruso. Are there tools for those who've shared some of the study findings? Actually, all three of you have shared study findings. Are there tools available so other people maybe can learn from them and try in their own locations? Really, anybody can respond to, actually, maybe all three of you could either answer that or respond in the answer box. Justine or Rebecca or Maneshka, are these tools publicly available or should people just email you? What would be the best way?
Yeah. From our part, people speaking at the same time.
Yeah.
We don't have the questions we asked or that survey from our social media channels is not publicly available, but we can share it if you mail us.
Okay, great. So
inspiration for how to ask questions.
Yeah. No, it's great for people to learn. And I think Maneshka is answering that in the Q&A box. So that's great. And then maybe Bethany can email Justine and see if there's some tools available.
Yeah, that would be okay. They can email.
Okay, great.
This is Justine.
Yeah. Great. And then there is a question from Erica. What will be a possible solution for workplaces in case we promote the use of reusable menstrual products like cloth pads? So is that something that came up for anyone? Rebecca.
Cloth pads are among the products that we're using in Nepal. We especially as a result of the pandemic, when we found that sometimes the disposable pads were not as freely available in the market, we decided to go with reusable pads. And many of the women had not heard of reusable pads before, so there has to be an education element as well. In the case of Kenya, we're also going with the cup.
Maneshka, the women had not heard of cloth or reusable pads. What were they using?
They were using kapada, which is old cloth.
Okay, great. Great to know. And then just a question, it's not in the chat box, but I just had it for Rebecca. How did you think to get started with the trade unions? I'm just curious what learning there is for people in other countries about where to get started as you did.
It was, like I mentioned, that we have a strong, pretty strong trade union movement in Sweden. And since all unions are member based, it's very easy to, if you're successful and have good collaborations, which we had, and we had a lot of representatives from different unions in a reference group.
Yeah.
They realized that this was an important issue, and they wanted to, at least if Metall and a few others wanted to continue to work with this.
Yeah.
And it's just, if it depends on how it looks from country to country, but it's a good, an efficient way to reach a lot of people in the work life, or workers.
And what kinds? I'm curious what kinds of jobs are reflected.
Sorry, what kinds of
jobs is the union represent? What kinds of work?
The ones that we had in a reference group came from the constructioning sector, and also IF Metall, which is industrial workers, like I said, and academic union. So it was very, and electricians.
Yeah.
So it was very, good representation from different kinds of
That's very diverse.
Jobs, which is also one of the reasons that we wanted to, broaden the material, since the first place we worked at was just like a regular office space, and it's of course a different challenge if you're, a bus driver or working outside than if you're sitting in an office.
Right.
So we could, cover more problems that people meet.
Yeah, great, thank you. So there's also one question, how do we change the perception that acknowledging menstrual health and hygiene needs and addressing them in the workplace is not anti-feminist and is actually pro-woman and pro-gender equity? Who are the most important stakeholders who need to be engaged around this attitude? Again, this seems more of a question for those looking at the workplace intervention. So I don't know if Maneshka or Rebecca want to try and answer that one.
I did We had a similar question in, was it from Siri?
Yeah.
It's a quite important one, since that's a common critique. And when we're out doing trainings, we kind of focus on the issue as workers' rights, and that all bodies have, needs, and they can differ from person to person or from where you are in life, and not just make it as like a women's issue, but that this is something that affects the whole workplace. And if you work with menstrual equity, you can also improve profitability, and it's better for everyone if the staff is happy.
Yeah, great. And then I see that, go ahead.
In the case of Nepal, we've decided to go with a holistic approach of engaging the men as well in the factories, the supervisors, management, but then also support systems like families, males in the families, mothers-in-law, as well as religious leaders.
Great. And that I actually had on my list a question to ask you. In engaging the men, how has that gone? I mean, you shared their opinions, but did they find it at all strange to be included, or did they assume of course to be included, or how did that go?
Sure. When we first started talking with them a year ago, Mani, they wanted to change the topic very quickly to soccer. But now they've started to get more interested in the topic of menstrual hygiene. And in fact, there are workers, male workers at the two factories whose families don't work in the factories. And they've been heard sending messages to their families, their daughters and their wives, about the project that we're doing and providing them information as well. So I think there's quite a good uptake.
Yeah, that's fantastic. Great. And then Justine, and then I'll come back to what's in the Q&A box, but you may, if you said this, apologies if I missed it, but the study focused on market workers, healthcare facility workers, and teachers, which is obviously three very important groups. Is there a reason that those were the three selected? I think.
Thank you. The reason why we concentrated, why we decided to start with the women in marketplaces, we wanted to know how women who are not highly educated, not very rich, not earning a lot of money, really cope with menstruation, so that we could get a fair picture of what happens to an ordinary person, not highly educated, not earning a lot, to see how they juggle with menstruation. Equal applies to teachers who are a bit educated, primary teachers are a bit educated, but they don't earn a lot. And yep. Also health workers wanted to know a little how they cope, if there was any difference in coping mechanism between teachers and health workers.
Got it. Okay, super, very helpful. And then another question. I'm not sure if this came up in any of your studies, but there was a question about what the women in your studies were using in terms of tracking their menstrual cycles. What method or tool was being used? Is that something anybody asked about?
No, we didn't ask about that.
Okay.
In this project specifically.
Okay. Oh, good. And then I think just one more question from me was to Justine. It was great to hear that the women felt comfortable and about 50% had spoken to healthcare workers. Do you have any idea why they had spoken to healthcare workers, if it was that they had heavy bleeding or were just trying to understand their cycle or pregnancy, or is that not something that you dug into, which would be totally understandable?
Yeah. Regarding, you know, speaking about menstruation at workplace, women felt that it was a taboo. It was not really expected of a responsible woman to start talking about menstruation challenges with the fellow workers. But those who went to facilities really, these were who had serious complications like pain, you know, heavy bleeding, and when they expressed their concerns to the health providers, they got some sort of relief that they had got someone to share with and who is not going to go back and start talking about their private life. So they really felt health workers were the best people to talk to other than colleagues at workplace.
Got it. Okay, wonderful, thank you. So I'm just going to, recognizing the time, I'm just going to move on from the Q&A. However, I see the question for email addresses, and I'm pretty sure our next slide or our next to next slide has all those addresses. So 1 second and we will get to that. Thank you again to our wonderful speakers for joining us today. It was just fantastic. I think we all learned a huge amount, and probably you're going to be getting some emails from those who are online. And we look forward to perhaps in another year hearing again about the workplace and what everybody's learning and how far we've come at that point. If you don't already receive our updates in terms of our webinars, please remember to sign up, and Jalen probably will put that in the chat box for those of you who don't have that link. We also want your ideas. We're gonna start thinking about speakers and topics for the fall and spring of next year. So please do let us know if you have any ideas that you think are important for this group to cover together. And as always, when we do send you an invitation to join, please feel free to forward those to your networks. As mentioned at the beginning, next month will be our final webinar for the season. And we will be talking about those experiencing homelessness and how they experience menstruation and the challenges that they face. A really critical issue, and one, at least here in the US, that I think has gotten worse in this time of the pandemic. And then here it is, I knew there was a slide. So if you do want to follow up with either myself or Caitlin, who is behind the scenes helping to manage and make sure that these webinars go smoothly, or any of the speakers who joined us today and did such beautiful presentations, please just take a screenshot or copy down their emails, and I'm sure they'll be happy to hear from you.